Good evening from Kyiv. It's 6 p.m. local time. In Kyiv, we have snow. During the last 2 days, it's not autumn, it's already the winter in Kyiv, but I'm sitting in a very cozy venue of exhibition Data Control Center. My name is Vitaly Moroz, and today I'm happy to launch the discussion on personal data protection. Today, we will be discussing many issues of protection of personal data, many challenges which face today's users in contemporary world. We start this discussion in time of pandemic, and people all around the world very carefully looking for all information which related to pandemic, consume a lot of information, and the next big question for everyone, will their users be ready to give up their personal data? This discussion is conducted within a bigger project which was initiated by Goethe Institute Ukraine in cooperation with Winkunst magazine and also Technical Tech Germany. The goal of the initiative is to increase media literacy of Ukrainian users and also to better protect personal data of Ukrainian users. I am delighted to introduce my colleague, Katerina Nakun, with whom I will be discussing for an hour all the aspects of personal data protection. I have a special message to our viewers. If you have any comments or questions, please do not hesitate to address them in our comments. We have a stream on Facebook, and you can leave your comments with your questions. Before giving the floor to Katerina, I would like to mention that in pandemic time, there is a lot of information and a huge information flow which is addressed to us as internet users. And it's not only discussion about coronavirus and its impact, but also many people try to find solution how to protect data in time of decisions from the government. Specifically in Ukraine, Ukrainian government, as many other governments, try to decrease the impact of pandemic, and the government suggests technical solutions, in particular providing application for self-isolation. But what is the implication of this app? How the data of the users is protected? All these issues we will discuss with Katerina Nakun. Katerina, welcome to our discussion. Is it snow in Berlin or not?
No, it's not snowing. Actually, I was some hours ago in the forest, and it's a very beautiful autumn. And yeah, it's rather warm, to be honest, like 15 degrees. And yeah, but happy to hear that you have already winter. I hope that we will at least have some snow at some point in Berlin.
Yeah, with every year we do expect snow because the global climate change makes us less confident that we'll have winters with snow. But when we will be back to begin of pandemic, to March or even February, probably nobody has expected that pandemic will last until the first snow in 2020. But the reality is different, and we don't know how many months or maybe years will be combating the pandemic. But let's turn to our discussion, and I want to ask Katerina. The situation within Germany. In Germany, you have much better regulations of personal data, since you have regulations based on European Union regulations. How do you feel personally? Do you feel safe enough to, when some institutions, either government or tech companies, collect and proceed your personal data?
Yeah, I would say it depends on the data and for which purposes it is stored, and if it's, for example, something I decided for myself because I'm a customer of a specific company, because I like the service and I trust this company, and it's totally something different when I'm obliged to give certain data or certain information about myself to a government institution, because from my point of view, there is a very fundamental difference between giving your data to a company and giving it to government institution, because of course there is a difference in what power these institutions have over me. If I'm not content with what a company does, then I can leave. I can say, please delete my data, and I move forward. But it's something different when a government institution stores data about me, especially when this data affects how I'm treated also by government institutions. 2 years ago, I wrote a book about privacy, and I had a very interesting experience because I did some experiments. I asked all kinds of different companies, what data do you have stored about me, such as Amazon. This ended in a very long-term letter friendship with the privacy department of Amazon. And in the end, they sent me like a huge Excel list with 15,365 clicks and 50 information items about every click, what they counted as a click. So it was everything I actually did in the last 14 months on Amazon. And on the other hand, I also requested data from government institutions. And, you know, I'm a rather boring person when it comes to my relationship with the police or secret services. I'm doing a lot of civil rights stuff. So I organize demonstrations. I'm also was part of several lawsuits against the government in front of the constitutional court in Germany. But I did nothing wrong, like in legal terms. And I was very surprised to find out, based on an information request, that my name was stored in the database of the German police for cybercrime. And I'm not a hacker, and I did nothing wrong. And then I requested, like, why do you store my name in the database for criminals? I mean, come on, what did I do wrong? I know nothing about this. How can this be? And then I found out that they just, someone accused me of something, and then the government institution decided, this is bullshit. Like in very plain words, this is totally nonsense. So we won't do a lawsuit against her. But in the end, still, even if I did nothing wrong, my name ended up in a database. And yeah. I don't know if this has had some negative effects on my life at some point, because I'm also sometimes invited to meetings with members of the German Secret Service, or, for example, the Ministry of Home Affairs, or politicians. And sometimes people do background checks on people like me meeting with important politicians. So I don't know if at some point someone thought, okay, Katharina Nokon, she's a cyber criminal or whatever. And it was clearly a mistake. And this shows how important the right to access your data is, because only because of this right that I have, I'm allowed to get a free copy of this data, I noticed that there was a mistake, and afterwards they immediately decided to delete this piece of data. So I'm not anymore in the database for criminals, but without asking, maybe I would be still in it. And this shows me how important it is that you have the right to request your data, to correct it, because otherwise this could have severe consequences for people, especially when we're talking about databases of government institutions.
activist and you are a net activist, so you know much more than ordinary citizens about your rights. But it do depends on society in which you live. If you live in a democratic society or a non-democratic society, and there is a huge issue of public trust within established democracies, you have much more public trust in institutions. And from your taxes, these institutions exist, they work, and they should be transparent to your request on how these taxes are spent. And compared to non-democratic societies where there is lack of trust between public institutions and citizens, what is your estimation? Is your government shows the signs of improving communications with citizens? Does it show the signs to provide better data protection, or still even within democracy there might be misuse on the level of government institutions?
Yeah, it depends. Of course, if you ask activists who is working in this field, I will tell you always there's a lot of room for improvement. For example, you have like a Freedom of Information Act in Germany, and based on that, you are allowed to request all kinds of, for example, a correspondence between a minister and like a company or whatever about a specific topic, as long as it's not labeled secret, and there are, of course, controls that like this label is not misused. As long as this is not the case, you can request this data. And this is, for example, important when we talk about lobbyism, when we talk about finding out, for example, the history or like how a specific text in the ministry got written, or what influences played a role there, or, for example, did like a specific politician had a meeting with someone else who was important, like all these kind of data you can request. And still, there are some organizations in Germany, such as Frag den Staat, who are suing a lot against government institutions, because sometimes they use copyright as kind of an excuse why they won't show a specific contract, but this contract, of course, affects something that has to do with tax spending and so on. And so there are still a lot of issues we need to solve. And what I found for especially also troubling right now is the huge debate we have about privacy in the context of COVID-19. Right now, we have a huge rise in the numbers of infections in Germany. And there are some debates whether or not we should lower our privacy levels in certain fields, so data can be used, for example, for contact tracing. But this is a very difficult discussion, because sometimes we talk here about very, very sensitive data, for example, the information like which contact a journalist has or someone who's politically active. This kind of data can be really used against this person. Or, for example, when you talk about contact data in the context of someone who's working someone who is a doctor, then it affects all the patients. And if this doctor is, for example, a psychiatrist, you know who's going to this psychiatrist. So this is like very sensitive data. And I'm really frightened that some people are right now very willing to give up on privacy, although you don't have really the proof that the measures were requested will really improve the situation. From my point of view, we have all kinds of different other troubles. For example, we have too many children going to school, sitting in a closed room with 30 other kids. We have really trouble with online teaching. This could be improved. Or, for example, we have still debates about how full the public transportation system is during specific hours, and people can also get infected in this way. And also we have not enough testing capacity. I know several friends who are waiting for their tests since a week, so maybe they don't need it anymore, they will just quarantine. But yeah, these are problems who are more urgent from my point of view than debates about privacy. But my feeling is that often also in different, in other fields, for example, when we talk about terrorism or when we talk about also different sorts of crimes, sometimes I have a feeling that some politicians have this image of technology, like if technology could solve all kinds of problems. Yeah, like if you only have an app for it, you can solve a problem. But many issues we have in society are much more complex, and it's easy to blame privacy or whatever than looking into it and sometimes discovering that we are really talking about much, much more complex topics that can't be solved with an app. Well, larger problems.
Katerina, when we talk about the pressure on the calls to give up the privacy, definitely the proponents of this idea may look on the East and provide example of China, which were quite successful in battling pandemic. But on the same time, we have great examples of Asian countries like Taiwan or South Korea, which are democratic countries, and they also managed to decrease the number of cases significantly. So I believe that when someone tries to compare with China, it's not very relevant. Because this system is very centralized, but at the same time, democratic countries also may provide very positive answers to combating pandemic. But I want to draw your attention to another country. Our discussion is called An Invisible Battle for Internet, How Governments and Tech Companies steal our data. Belarus, the country where the protest continues for more than 3 months, and the latest data from Belarus shows that approximately 30,000 of protesters were detained during the last 3 months. And this is authoritarian regime with the huge violations of human rights. And from my communication with activists from Belarus, they mentioned that law enforcement agencies, police, they detain people, and the first what they push protesters is to unlock their smartphones, because the protests are not centralized in Belarus. There is no political leadership for the protests, but the protests rely on social media, in particular Telegram, as a way to communicate. And in fact, police push hardly to show all the context, to see the conversations which activists have in Telegram. And when they see some secret chats, they detain them up to 15 days in prison. Can you imagine the situation when in democratic country, the police will approach pedestrian activists and ask to show secret chats or messenger and see what is the context. What is the safeguards in democratic regimes against such bad practices?
Yeah, actually, we have a huge debate right now whether or not the police should be allowed to request operators of messengers to build in backdoors for government institutions. And I think this is a very dangerous situation, because right now, of course, there are specific safeguards. We have in some countries, governments are allowed, for example, to use malware to install it on your laptop or on your smartphone under specific conditions. And of course, in some cases, or in most countries, you have a judge who is deciding whether or not this is a reasonable act to do in a situation. But the problem I see with this general debate about governments using spyware or malware or install something on your computer which tries to read out your messages or emails or even send a copy of your what you have on your hard drive. This is a security loophole, and this security loophole from a technical perspective can also be used by others for example by criminals or by other government agency, maybe even from non-democratic countries. So I think this whole debate about banning surveillance or banning encryption and making it very hard for normal users to use encryption is a very dangerous debate, because it's easy to talk about, yeah, there are these stable democracies and there are these unstable democracies. But when I sometimes in the last weeks, when I look through the newspaper and read what is happening in the US right now, I'm not really sure that we can be sure that stable democracies will always stay stable. So I think we should really care about what kind of what kind of safeguards we have concerning surveillance abilities for police and secret services, and also whether or not it's reasonable to allow specific things at all. Because from my point of view, what's on my smartphone or what's on my computer, this is like, this is like the most private thing in my life. Yeah, it's all the communication with my friends, with my family, all my photos. And some people store very personal things on their computer. It's like reading a diary from a person. Yeah. And so I think we need to have this debate whether or not there should be a space, a personal space for a human being, which should be safe from access of government institutions. And I'm really against laws that enable governments to access encrypted data of citizens, because making loopholes or making security backdoors inside of secure technology is like making something which is secure insecure, and you never know when like political environment might change. And we have in Germany we have a very different point of view on privacy. It's sometimes my feeling when I talk to activists from other countries. I remember 10 years ago I told them, we had this demonstration against data retention law in Germany, and there were I think 30,000 people, and they were, what, for a privacy issue, 30,000 people on the street? How did you do that? And you need to understand, in Germany we talk about this topic from a very specific perspective because of our history, because we had incidents, or we know from history that data kinds of databases which were like not computer databases but like the old paper ones which contained religion and so on, which were made without any no one wanted to harm anyone by, for example, register the religion of someone. But in the end, the Nazis used it to kill the Jewish population in some European countries. So we always, I think it's reasonable when you talk about what governments are allowed to do and what not, how this data or like how this legal option could be abused if you have like a right-wing government. And when I look at European politics, I'm not so confident that the next 10, 20 years will be political as stable as the last 20 years.
Katharina, but you probably bring the big issue of regulations of internet space, and it's definitely from the human rights perspective, there should be no limitations for free conversation online, for free assembly online. But at the same time, in some countries, technologies may be misused not only on the level of government, which is linked to authoritarian regimes, but also for specific groups like religious groups. And you probably know about the discussion about the role of WhatsApp and the case of genocide in Myanmar, where WhatsApp as a technology was used to spark this hatred, and it led it to killings of people. And these regulations, it's a big question where the limits of these regulations should be self-regulations, and should tech giants step forward and say, we want to regulate ourselves, or they should wait until the government will say how they should be regulated in order to keep lives of people in such regimes. I understand it's a quite big issue, but do you believe in self-regulations or co-regulations of tech companies?
Yeah, my experience is that self-regulation often takes place shortly after debates whether or not governments should regulate. So my point of view is that companies often say, yeah, we will get it done by yourself. We don't need your regulation. We don't need your help. We will do it anyways. But I'm not sure whether, yeah, this result would have happened without the huge debate whether or not something should be regulated. For example, after the Cambridge Analytica scandal, we had a lot of debates whether or not political ads on Facebook should be regulated. And I experienced this time also as a huge change in how Facebook talked about privacy in public and also possible manipulation in public, because before I had the impression that the company was in most interviews or also in many hearings, it was like, yeah, no problem, privacy is something from the 90s, we don't need it anymore, we want to connect people, you know, we are the good guys. And after Cambridge Analytica, this was not possible anymore. And I also have a feeling that when it comes to disinformation and also spreading hate speech and calls to violence over social networks, the debate has changed dramatically during the last year. I published this year a book about conspiracy theories with a friend. She's a psychologist. And before that, we looked up how, for example, social media is regulated when it comes to obviously fake facts, such as the Earth is flat or there is a 5G conspiracy or whatever. And before COVID-19, this was spreading disinformation was in most contexts seen as something like, come on, you shouldn't care. This is only a small group of people. And there shouldn't be a problem. But I think COVID-19 was here really an international game changer, because at this point, people actually realized that spreading disinformation can kill people, basically, because when people don't believe that COVID-19 is dangerous, they won't take care so much about not getting infected or not infect others. So I think this was a global game changer, because before that we had a lot of debates about what happened in several countries, but my impression was that the companies sometimes just changed a bit in some countries and in others not, and in some countries there are fact checks and in others not. But during COVID-19 I also experienced that the recommendation algorithm in YouTube changed dramatically in a way that more fact checks and others were more fact checking videos were offered to people who watched obviously conspiracy theory content. And from my point of view, this is a very, very difficult debate also, because when we talk about regulation or when we talk about regulating disinformation or fake news, the question is always what is seen as fake news or disinformation, for example, by the Ukrainian governments, but we need to consider also what is seen by the Russian government as disinformation or fake news, or by the Chinese government. So this is a very, very difficult situation to talk about regulation, because something you find reasonable in a specific context of a democratic country might be misused a lot in other contexts where the president, for example, is someone who's spreading a lot of disinformation and just wants that his political opponents will be somehow silenced on social media through such laws. You also need to anticipate this, but at the same point, I see myself that the spread of disinformation, especially through the radical right, is something that also results in real life violence. I get death threats from right-wing extremists in Germany, and this changed my life a lot, and not in a positive way. And I know that online echo chambers, so-called, if you want to believe in this theory, or filter bubbles, whatever, but people radicalize in this environment, they sometimes also turn out to be violent in real life. And that's something I think we need to discuss as a society. But regardless of how we regulate, I think we need more transparency from the tech giants, especially when it comes to recommendation algorithms, or the question why something is, for example, pushed in a feed, and which information is not, or is rather ranked down in a feed, and why, and whether or not we find these rules that shape so much of what we see online, whether these rules are reasonable, or whether or not they can also be abused or change public debates in a way that is not healthy for us.
We probably have some kind of dependency of tech giants, because our digital life moved online to the platforms. Many Ukrainians do use Google, many Ukrainians do use Facebook, and it's hard to refuse, like, or to switch to some more transparent platforms, to the platforms with better personal data protection or better algorithm. I will turn back to your book. In fact, the media consumption in Ukraine and worldwide has increased during the pandemic time, since people were locked in their houses, in their homes. They turned to consumption media, and they were quite consuming the news about the spread of pandemic. They also turned to Netflix, and in Ukraine, Netflix came just a couple of months ago, and it was a huge, huge enthusiasm about more platforms, more video streaming platforms. Because before, in Ukraine, we had only some local video streaming platforms, and Netflix was a game changer, in fact. And many users posted positively, saying, "Hey, I have so much. I have access to so many episodes on Netflix, and it's much better, and it has good quality." And I haven't heard any discussions about the privacy and about the terms of use of Netflix, because it's not very interesting. Let's be honest. Nobody wants to read 20 pages of terms of use of Netflix. From your perspective, you wrote your book based on this request to Netflix, and if you can provide any advices why we should be careful with learning how tech giants works, how they collect our data, and what we should do as customers to make sure that our data is not misused by such companies as Netflix, or maybe it's not misused because we have agreed on the terms of use.
Yeah, people often say, or like some experts say, if you are not paying for a service, then you are not the customer, but you are the product. I always was a fan of the sentence, but I don't think it's right anymore because I'm obviously a customer of Amazon and I'm obviously a customer of Netflix because I need to be a customer to do this data request. And they still surveil me. Yeah, even companies where I have a contract, I pay them. Yeah, in the case of Netflix, it's not... I pay them quite a lot of every month, and still they trace every click I do. When I wrote my book about what companies and governments know about you and me, I did an information request based on the GDPR at Netflix, and you can do it via email based on the GDPR, the European Privacy Regulation. And they are obliged to answer you in during a period of a month what kind of data they have, and they need to provide you a free copy. So I did that, and they sent me, first of all, a lot of information about like which movie I watched. It was embarrassingly a lot of trash series and movies. But then I also asked, well, do you have maybe other information such as at which point of a film or a video I clicked on fast forward or backwards and or rewind or stop maybe. And then they said, well, we found some data, and they sent me another list, and I really could see at which point of the video I clicked on stop, at which point of the video I clicked on fast forward, and so on. And maybe for people who don't understand how problematic this is, please ask yourself in which situations you click on stop or fast forward, or if you, when do you like switch to a specific place in the video. Yeah, some people, when they don't feel good at in the evening alone, they watch the kitschy ending of their favorite movie 5 times after one after another, where some people are not or don't want to see violent parts of a movie, so they click fast forward. Some people see violent scenes several times because they like them so much, and some people, maybe teenagers or whatever, they watch sex scenes they like several times. So from my point of view, this is very intimate data. This is not only what kind of movie I have seen, but also like what part of the movie is most interesting for me. And this is kind of disturbing because at some points I understand that Netflix wants to collect data to recommend another movies to me I might like. But at the same time, you could provide these kind of services without storing this kind of data. So I really would recommend users to, if there's an option to get a copy of your data, just check it out. In most cases, if you can do it under the GDPR, or if the company offers this option, then it's really something worthwhile doing, because it's one thing to know in the abstract like this company is storing something about me, and it's something totally different to have a copy of all these things maybe printed out. And in the case of Netflix, it was this, like it was so much paper. And in the case of Amazon, it was a paper trail which was bigger than me. It was almost 2 meters high, if I would have printed it out. And you will think different about your private data after seeing this, because when I looked through all this data of Amazon, but also of Netflix, I was thinking like, what if someone who doesn't know me sees this data, and what image does it create of me? And in the case of Netflix, you also need to keep in mind that there are also like innovative kinds of movies or interactive movies where you can make decisions. Yeah, and based on what decision you choose, there might be a different ending. And for example, Netflix Bandersnatch, Black Mirror Bandersnatch is such a movie. And of course, you could do psychological profiling based on the decision a player or someone who watches this movie chooses. Like, for example, do you choose the option kill your father? And if you do that, do you want to bury the corpse in the garden or not? Yeah, this is this is really happening in this movie. And it's kind of disturbing that the company chooses to store this kind of data for a long time. And especially in cases where I pay for a service, and especially when I talk about services who are used by teenagers and kids a lot, then I think we should really talk about whether or not it's reasonable to store so much data about so many people, because Netflix could provide their services with the same, with no difference without such a huge data collection.
Katerina, but I also know that huge companies like tech companies, they not just collect data, they not only proceed personal data, but they also delete this data. And it depends in which period of time they do delete. If they delete in 3 years and they keep it for 3 years, or they delete it much earlier. But the Netflix, Amazon, the companies you have mentioned, so they are the champions of digital economy and digital market, and the world is moving, is trying to be more, to have more digital market, in fact. And more companies try to provide services online. In Ukraine, in time of pandemics, let's talk about how the digital economy is changing in time of pandemic. And I want to show you example how online services can be beneficial for customers. In Ukraine, on time of pandemic, there is a project which is called Medicine 24, Liki 24, and this project collects data from all pharmacies around the city and provide customers with the cheaper drugs. Before the prices on drugs in Ukraine are not regulated by government, so one medicine can be can have absolutely different price, and nobody knows which price he or she will get in the pharmacy. So this is a great example how technologies helped customers to choose the cheapest medicine in the area, and there is a delivery, quite cheap delivery. But this is a very simple example of a digital economy and how healthcare is changing during time of pandemic. But we will have a big issue on insurance, I believe. So many patients of affected by COVID-19, and in the following years, more and more people will come to the insurance companies and will ask for insurance of their health and their life. What is the impact of COVID on this industry?
Yeah, it's difficult to tell how COVID-19 will, in the end, change everything, probably. But first of all, to your regarding your example with access to cheap medication and of course spreading making the information transparent about the pricing of medication. Most people I know who are concerned or working in the field of privacy are at the same time huge fans of open data, and I think we need to draw a line, like what kind of data is really private data, because I mean it's something different when I say, for example, I share the information that I bought a specific cancer medication. Yeah, this is a very private information, but because you could, based on that, you know that I might have cancer, and or the information that someone bought a cancer medication and how the price was. So we need to really to separate these two parts, and it's that I mean, there is no contrast in saying at the same times I'm totally pro privacy, and at the same time I'm in favor of open data. Yeah, for me, this is these are two parts of the same battle, or like the same fight for technology that can improve our lives. And but when we talk about privacy and insurance companies, this is really something I think that might change in the next years, because when you look at how health insurances or how health insurance contracts are changing or have changed in the last years in some countries which don't have any regulation or very little regulation on this, you see that there is a trend to an individualization of healthcare contracts. For example, in a specific contract, they tell you, yeah, if you pay so much, if you agree that you have a fitness tracker, and based on this fitness tracker, we need to know that you walk at least 10,000 steps every day. And if you have achieved this goal, that then you pay this amount. And if you don't manage to do this, then you need to pay a certain amount of money as a penalty. And we see these kind of contracts in many countries, and I think this is very troubling, because this would be the end of solidarity when it comes to healthcare, from my point of view. Because of course, at first, when you talk about people's about this issue with people, some might say, yeah, but if you're lazy, why should others pay for your laziness? Because you don't care about your body, and then you maybe get sick, and why should others pay for that? But imagine when you have, for example, when you are as a mother alone with a child, and you don't have the money for a babysitter. Like, how should you go jogging after your work, and you work maybe inside an office, so you don't move a lot? Should this mother maybe walk around in her living room in circles to achieve the goal of 10,000 steps in order to not pay more money, because maybe she can't afford a better health insurance or pay more for her health insurance? And I really fear that we end with this individualization of healthcare contracts, that we really end up in a two-class system where people who have a lot of money can afford a good health insurance. They really don't need to care about these kind of contracts, because they won't have one, yeah? Because they will still have privacy when it comes to all their body functionalities, but people who don't have a lot of money, who wants to have the cheapest contract, they will be forced to agree to these kind of contracts. And I'm really pro regulating this whole field of healthcare insurances in as strict way as possible, to prevent that we will have these kind of separation between people who can afford privacy in the healthcare sector and people who are forced to give it up. And regarding COVID-19, of course, it will be an interesting question whether or not, for example, private healthcare insurances will ask you before you join, did you have COVID-19? Yeah, because we still know very little about the long-term effects of the sickness.
Affordable healthcare is a big issue for Ukraine as well. And still, according to constitution, according to Ukrainian laws, all Ukrainian citizens are may ask for free of charge healthcare system, but it still actually it doesn't work, and more people go and buy some services from insurance companies. But I want to move to the side of solutions from the government, and in time of pandemic, Ukrainian government wanted to control the spread of coronavirus, and it suggested the mobile application, which is called Stay at Home, Dii Vdoma, and it was targeted for travelers in the early stages of pandemic. The government has decided that there is a countries of red zone with a high risk of infection, and they pushed Ukrainian citizens to install the application when they were back from their trips, from their travels. And they were obliged either to take a test or to install this self-isolation application. And for 14 days, for 2 weeks, they needed to respond to the signals from the app to confirm their location, that they are on self-isolation. And for many users, there was a frustration because this app was prepared just in 5 days, and probably there were no safeguards, and it wasn't explained where the data is stored, how it is proceeded, and how much time it will be stored in some government institutions. Have you experienced or have you seen maybe more successful examples and first of all effective applications from the government, and should they be voluntary or should they be obligatory, as in Ukrainian case? What is your opinion?
I mean, in the Ukraine, as far as I've seen, this app is for a very specific case. If you come from another country and you enter Ukraine, and then still you have a choice whether or not you want to take a test or you want to choose the app, or if you want to isolate in a hotel. So at least you have some choice. But as far as I read, there were quite some problems with the app. For example, you could also talk about whether or not this app should also be available in different languages, or for example, when you talk about people who come maybe from another country, from another time zone, enter Ukraine, and then you need to react to this app in this very specific time window, but you have a jet lag, like, and there are difficult use cases. And of course, it's always, I think it's not always the best choice to decide to develop an app in only 5 days, which, especially if this app decides about a lot in people's life. In other countries, I've seen a lot of different contact tracing apps, which are a totally different use case. In this case, you have an app on your smartphone permanently, and if you go, for example, around the city and other people have the same corona contact tracing app on their smartphone, then these two apps kind of make an encrypted handshake and say hello. And if you say hello for more than 15 minutes, then your app knows that, okay, this is like a contact, maybe you could get infected by this person if this person had corona. And if you have corona, then you say, tell your app, hey, I've a positive test, please spread the word to all the tell the system, please spread the word that I'm infected to all my contacts who you have stored with this app. And I think contact tracing apps are a very good idea, but I think also that privacy should be an essential part of a process, because there are countries where you are obliged to install such an app. So you are obliged always to have this app. And I think this is problematic because on the one hand, of course, this discriminates people who don't have a smartphone at all. I mean, there are maybe not that many people who don't have a smartphone, but especially when we talk about people from the risk group, elderly people, that these cases happen, and what do you do about them? Like, do you want to make penalties because someone decides just doesn't want to own a smartphone? I think this is a very difficult question. And at the same time, we also see that in different countries, they have different technological solutions. For example, in some countries, these are centralized systems where, like, for example, a government institution can access all of this data. Like, with whom I was drinking coffee for the last 2 weeks. And this is in a case of someone who's politically active, a very sensitive information. And also this is a very sensitive amount of data about all of a country in general. So what the this, there is a data leak or whatever, or a security breach, I think this might not be the best solution. And but there are also other systems which decide that we don't want to have a centralized system because of the problems this creates, also when we talk about power and the possibility to abuse this kind of sensitive data. But they use a decentralized system instead, where you say we need to have safeguards. For example, you don't connect the information about the contacts with names, so you have kind of non-personalized data. And I think this is a good decision to care about in this process about privacy, because privacy creates trust, and you need to have, or you need to get people to trust in this app that they will have no disadvantages by using it. Otherwise, they won't use it. Yeah, and in this case of the German contact tracing app, it's decentralized. It's you don't store like a centralized who is meeting whom, and the government for sure has no can't access these kind of data. And we have more than 20 million downloads. It's not that much. I mean, I would be happy if it would be more, but still, it's more than I think the choice would be a technological solution that doesn't care about privacy at all, because especially when we talk about the information, whether or not I'm infected, yeah, this is a very sensitive information. So to entrust this information to an app is for, especially for elderly people, like a huge step. And that's why I'm very happy that we had a very huge and fiercely debate in Germany about this app, and privacy activists and human rights activists and encryption activists started really to go into this debate and say, no, dear government, sorry to interrupt, but what you are trying to do is not a good solution, and it will not work. So in the end, this was kind of a success story also for the German privacy or internet activist groups, because there were also plans to solve this differently.
Yeah, but it looks that any kind of government solution within these apps or any other like solutions, they will be always criticized from civil society, because civil society stands on the human right approach, and it's hard to say if government can stand on the human right approach in their activities. Within your observations, you have mentioned a very interesting topic that some people might not have smartphones and can't install any kind of applications. According to the data from Ukrainian Ministry of Digital Transformation, the digital divide in Ukrainian society has 5.8 million people who do not have access to high-speed internet, broadband internet, and the government plans to cover in the following years almost 6 million of people and provide them with high-speed internet. But it's also a huge debate for the industry, because government wants that the industry and providers and operators would build the infrastructure. On the same time, private sector says, oh, we don't have enough resources to build infrastructure in a very small, tiny villages, and it's not profitable for us to operate in these areas. I want to ask you, if there is a digital divide in Germany, and or maybe 95% of German population have access to high-speed internet, and even elderly people have smartphones in their apartments.
Let me frame it like this. When I, from Berlin, when I go by car to Poland, where I was born and where I still have family, I don't have any internet access for navigation until I pass the border to Poland. Yeah. So we have areas, especially rural areas in the east of Germany, where it's a catastrophe. It's really a catastrophe. I mean, you don't have even you have only Edge for your smartphone. And yeah, if you live there, it's very difficult to do home office when you work, have something to do with media or internet or IT, whatever. Yeah, any kind of home office because of the internet connection. And of course, this is not the majority of Germany, and but still, I think especially in this during this pandemic, this creates a huge digital divide, because it makes a difference when someone say, yeah, you can work from home on your project, and you're living in a rural area where you don't have a very good internet connection. And I just read yesterday on Twitter that, I mean, in German TV, we have now like Zoom or Skype video conferences all the time, like instead of interviews that takes place in the studio. And there was the Berlin-wide network, and they had three interviews with three different people, and every time the internet connection was not stable.
So yeah, it
tells you a lot about the problems you have. And I also see that there is a huge difference between the interests of the telecommunication operators, which say, yeah, it doesn't generate profit, for example, to connect these rather rural areas. And I don't think also that the German government did the best strategic decisions in the last year. And every time I'm on holidays somewhere, somewhere outside Germany, I'm almost crying when I upload something. I'm almost crying.
But it's summertime, and maybe you probably don't need so much internet as in your regular life. But we still we are located in the big cities, and we presume as normal to have a high-speed internet. Katharina, we'll probably come into the end of our discussion, but we still have some questions from our viewers. So I want to ask this question. Anton Kudinov asking two following questions. Where is the border, where is the line between personal data protection and the cases when personal data has influence on public interest? Is it understandable, or maybe to rephrase it? Where is the line between personal data protection and the situations when personal data can influence public interest? Maybe it's the issue of anonymous data which is not personal, for example, for health issues, for research in medicine.
Yeah, I mean, this is actually what I try to describe by drawing a line between privacy and open data. I think many privacies debates we have about whether or not, for example, the data of patients with cancer can be accessed for medical research purposes would be a totally different one if we would say, yeah, okay, you can access this data, but before that, we will take care that you can't connect any like name or real name or person to this data after we gave it to you. And there are a lot of techniques when it comes to anonymization of data sets, very good mathematical concepts, but you still need to take care that you at least know that there is this option. And I also think that when we talk about recommendation algorithms, for example, with Netflix, that a lot of that could also be done if data would be anonymized, because maybe it's not that important that someone with the name Katharina Nukun watched a certain movie. We can also name this person differently, or just leave out the name and still have a very important piece of information for a recommendation service. So especially when it comes to public data, I think we need to talk more about the option to anonymize data set, because in this case we can just use all the chances and all the options we have, positive options based on the use of open data, without having the civil rights implication when we talk about privacy.
I want to ask you another question from Anton Kudinov, but I will rephrase the question. Is there any negative outcomes of implementation of GDPR for public good?
Yeah, of course, not everything about the GDPR is perfect. We had a lot of debates before the GDPR came into effect, because a lot of small and medium enterprises were very not sure how they should deal with the situation, what are the rules, and for sure a lot of lawyers, maybe not the best lawyers, maybe not the best privacy lawyers, made some money by like giving not the best recommendations to and the state has changed a lot during the last 2 years, because we have also based on GDPR, we also have more which are specialized and which are GDPR compliant.
Katharina, I have.
But of course, okay.
I have. We're running out of time, and I have probably final question. But this question from anonymous user is regarding the fight against propaganda. What is the best way to fight against Russian propaganda machine for Ukraine? Is it the good option to fight against fakes, or it's better to make the first strike and occupy? So-called occupy Russian media sphere?
Yeah, it's a very difficult question, and I guess maybe I'm not the best expert on this issue to ask, because I think you have a very different point of view and a very different experience on this topic than someone who's more focused on German politics. But I'm also frightened by the option that foreign governments can, for example, through disinformation campaign on social media, can try to influence, especially during election public debates. And my lessons learned from also debates we had in Europe is that we also should maybe push like the old media to get more education about social media, because sometimes I have a feeling you can generate a lot of noise on social media about specific topics with just a small amount of accounts. And we know, for example, in Germany that we had the case that radical right-wing extremist groups, they like ask their members, please create 20 accounts, for example, on Twitter, so we have fake accounts and we can try to push certain hashtags during election campaigns. And I'm sure that this is an option which is also used by other political groups, maybe also by foreign governments. So I think we really need to make sure that in cases where something like this happens and you can't prevent this, that also disinformation, misinformation is spread, or like, for example, the feeling of that a large group is for or against a specific measure without being backed up by real people, but rather by maybe fake accounts, that we need to have people and journalists who are aware of this option and check carefully whether or not we are talking, for example, about accounts who seem to be a bit fishy or maybe not reliable, and also now like the basics about social media, that you can buy followers and so on. This is like really low level, but I still have a feeling that especially when you talk sometimes to older journalists from newspapers, without wanting to offend someone, but this is just a different generation, and but they need to know these basics in order to have safeguards against also influences from social media campaigns. And also still, I think it's a good idea to have fact-checking on social media, but only in the case if these fact-checkers are not directly working or at Facebook, but if these fact-checking happens at some other news agencies or like professional journalists and so on, because otherwise it's almost impossible to counter disinformation from my experience, like with fact checks in real time, because people who are spreading disinformation have in most cases much more resources. And if you repeat just disinformation often enough, that it tends to keep in the minds of the people who read it, regardless whether they want to believe it or not. It just, what wires together, fires together, is a saying from psychology. And that's why, this is an important topic.
Katerina, while ending our discussion, I will still ask probably the last but not the least question, and it's regarding the strategy, how to protect personal data and protect privacy. So on the one hand, we can push the governments to adopt better legislation and to be more careful with proceeding personal data of citizens. On the other hand, on the individual level, we probably should be more aware about our personal data when we provide consent on our data. What is the terms of use of social media networks and all the websites we browse? What will be the best approach? Should it be a combination of the approaches in order to come to this ideal situation when we feel secured and protected?
Yeah, I mean, it's a difficult question. You can find me also on like an alternative social media platform, which is called Mastodon, which is decentralized, open source, without advertisement, like the dream, like maybe Twitter should be, if it would be not Twitter. But at the same time, I know that companies, they love these debates about, you are responsible for all the things which are happening because you chose to be a customer at Amazon and you choose to watch Netflix and you use Google for Googling. How can you? And without you, we would have like a perfect dream world. But in fact, when we talk about the use cases of people, why they use specific platforms, then we just need to acknowledge that we are talking about almost monopolistic structures in these markets. Like, tell someone who's 16 years old not to use WhatsApp or Instagram or maybe TikTok if everyone else in their class is using it. And if you're not using it, you're out. Yeah? You're not part of a social game anymore, especially during a pandemic. So I would be very reluctant to say this is a very voluntary decision. Or you can also say, if someone is a huge fan of House of Cards, like a very specific TV series, and he's rather reluctant to use Pirate Bay or other not so legal options, then okay, then they will be Netflix customers, but only because you are a customer and you agree because you want to watch the series. But doesn't mean that you say everything this company is doing is fine. So I dream of a world where we have like a very basic regulation about very basic privacy things. And also when we talk about how this data is used to manipulate people, where I can just be sure if this company is, for example, this service is offered to me in my country, that this basic baseline of privacy is met. I don't need to care about it, yeah, because there are guidelines and there's regulation. And especially in markets where you don't have that much of a competition, I mean, name just the number three or number two behind Google when we talk about search engines. Name the number two of social media. Yeah, it's difficult in these markets. You don't have real competition, you don't have a real choice, and that's why we need government regulation, I guess. And of course, it helps when people make a choice and say, and for example, when I do a search, have a search request which is sensible, like for example, something to do with healthcare, maybe I don't use Google, but I use Startpage or DuckDuckGo, or maybe I give Mastodon, like this alternative social network without advertisement, a try. And also, with regarding to your operating system, maybe I can give Ubuntu or Linux a try. But still, I think on only a certain percentage of people will have this choice and also will have the capacity and the resources to make this choice, because it also requires a certain level of education, also technical education. For example, when we talk about, yeah, you can encrypt your emails, for me this is an easy task, but maybe for my uncle this is rather a difficult task, but because he has, yeah, you know. And that's why I think regulation is really the solution here.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Katharina. It was very thoughtful discussion, and I want to explain our viewers that if you read in English or in German, you can search online and buy the books written by Katharina, and all these two books focuses on the issues of data protection and on fake news. And maybe in some day we'll have these books published in Ukrainian language, so you can better understand what is the level of discussion about personal data protection and fake news in Germany. And all our viewers, I also want you to invite to go to the website of the Data Control Center. It is online exhibition. It has two dimensions, online space on the website, which you will find on the Facebook page, but also you can come to the venue and see all details about data protections and many other issues regarding control of your personal data. Thank you so much and goodbye.